It is at this desk that some of the major decisions of our time are made. The CBS television network takes you to the office of the Secretary of State in Washington, D.C. We are at the source, the physical setting in which Dean Rusk, the Secretary of State, thinks and works and acts on important questions of foreign policy. In an informal and spontaneous discussion recorded earlier today, Secretary Rusk meets with Chief CBS News Washington correspondent Howard K. Smith and CBS News correspondents Bill Downs and Paul Niven. Now, let us join their discussion at the source. Here is Howard K. Smith.
Mr. Secretary, you've had a long and varied experience as a subordinate in the State Department, and now that you've had 5 months as the head of the State Department, have you learned anything you didn't know then?
Well, when I was one of 10 assistant secretaries back 10 years ago, I thought then that life was fairly complicated and busy. It's no less so today. I think the thing that I did not appreciate 10 years ago is that the secretary almost never has the fun of dealing with a simple question. Those are handled by his colleagues down the line. Most of the questions which come to the secretary's desk and go from there to the president, these days, given the pace and complexity of our relations with the rest of the world, are, shall I say, most interesting and usually complicated and difficult.
Well, Mr. Secretary, we who wander around this big building, which is your headquarters here, have sort of a saying that if you're pessimistic 100% of the time, while you're 99% of the time, you're right. But there must be another side of the coin. Hasn't something ridiculous happened to you since you've been in? Something funny?
Oh, I think there are a number of amusing things which happen along the way. It might be a little embarrassing to spell them out here, but there are always unearned dividends in this job. Some perfectly ridiculous event occurring somewhere that no one could have predicted, with not grave consequences, but adds to the gaiety and the enlightenment of the world scene. No, there's fun in this job, too.
I suppose the least funny aspect of life today for you is Berlin, Mr. Secretary. It's now 2.5 years since Khrushchev said he was going to sign a peace treaty with East Germany. Have our contingency planners in that time made a tentative decision as to where we draw the line? Do we let him sign his peace treaty with East Germany and wait for the East Germans to stop our trucks, or do we resist the peace treaty itself?
Mr. Niven, the president yesterday in his press conference made a very important statement on this question, and I don't suppose it would be well for high officials to make fresh statements on almost a daily basis on such a serious question. But let me say this in direct answer to your particular question. The essence of our commitment there, of our rights, and the basis for our concern about the future in West Berlin is the right of the three powers, the United States, United Kingdom, and France in West Berlin, our obligations and responsibilities to the people in West Berlin, and the commitment of the West to the security and freedom of West Berlin. Now, there are a great many questions which have been discussed and talked about, formula, proposals, counter-proposals, but this is the essence of the matter. We are there by right, not by sufferance. We have obligations to ourselves and to the people of West Berlin, and we do not accept the notion that those rights can be terminated or that the security of the people of that city can be endangered by the unilateral action taken by someone else.
Mr. Secretary, a thing that bothers me, and I think bothers a great many people, is the thought that we may be prepared to be firm against an all-out, all-at-once warlike threat in Berlin. But the possibility exists that the Russians won't give us such a challenge. Instead, they will try to shave away our rights in installments so small that none will seem worth fighting about. Are we prepared to face the possibility that they will attempt first to grant East German puppet police the right to police our traffic, then delay the traffic, then harass the traffic? Are we prepared to meet that threat?
Well, this is one of the problems which will have to be thought about, considered, planned for in our discussions within our own government and with other governments. In a situation of this sort, the Soviets would probably try to create an ambiguous situation because these are more difficult to handle and deal with and to explain publicly.
What do you mean, sir?
along the lines of Mr. Smith's comments. That is, to leave it uncertain, to let whatever action occur with hesitancy or with concealment or with indirectness, because the underlying issues are simple and direct. And these must be understood by our own people and by peoples in other countries. And it's important to keep the ambiguities cleared away so that we know exactly what the issues are.
Well, if we agree that freedom is not negotiable in Berlin, what is?
Well, since 1946, the Western powers have made a series of proposals for a permanent settlement in Germany and in Berlin. These have taken a variety of forms over the years. Most of them have had to do with the self-determination of the peoples concerned. This is an instinctive American reaction to the way in which you go about settling questions of this sort. Ask the people themselves what solution they themselves want. And in the long turn of history, this also may be the wise course in looking for a permanent solution. Because history is full of situations where the absence of self-determination has led to ambitions, appetites, revanchist ideas, which in turn disturb the peace.
Do you expect this crisis to unfold according to any kind of a timetable, Mr. Secretary?
The timetable is, of course, depends upon all parties here. Mr. Khrushchev has indicated that he expects to take certain action by the end of the year. That does not mean that he might not raise one or another part of this question before then. That also does not mean that everyone else would wait until the end of the year to address themselves to it. So I think that it's safe at this time to say, Mr. Niven, that the Berlin question is going to be with us as an active question on our agenda, both before the government and the American people, for the next several months, anyhow.
Was there a hint there that we may try to beat him at his own game by proposing negotiations?
Well, I think there's no question that there will be discussions among governments about Berlin, including discussions with the Soviet Union. In the first instance, for example, we will be replying to Mr. Khrushchev's aide memoir on the subject. When you raise the question of negotiation, this, to some people, implies a particular form or forum or way of talking. What I'm saying is that undoubtedly this question is going to be discussed, but under what circumstances and what way will be reached in the course of discussions among governments now going on.
Mr. Secretary, Winston Churchill once said that if the Allies had made it perfectly clear to the Germans before either World War that they would fight and just where they would draw the line, there wouldn't have been either World War. Would it not, in view of that, be an act of wisdom to let the Russians know exactly what we would not permit? For example, if we would not permit their East German police to take over the stamping of our traffic papers into and out of Berlin?
The issue mentioned by Mr. Churchill is a central one in relations between a dictatorship, an authoritarian form of government, and the democracies. Because it's relatively easy for a highly centralized regime to underestimate the political processes which go on in a democratic society. We debate vigorously among ourselves, we differ with each other, have all sorts of internal quarrels as we sort out our political arrangements on a democratic basis, and indeed in our discussions with our friends abroad. There is considerable public discussion of different points of view on important questions among thriving democracies. Now, there is a temptation on the part of an authoritarian ruler to think that this is a sign of weakness or lack of unity. Indeed, a miscalculation on this point, an estimate that democracies would not do what in fact they would do, is a source of danger. So there will be a number of points of clarification of purpose and procedure and issue aimed at the avoidance of this kind of miscalculation.
And these will be made public, will they?
Public and, I presume, in the course of intergovernmental discussions.
Well, Mr. Secretary, Walter Lippmann this morning said that it's the unstated policy of Britain and France to preserve the division of Germany as it now is, we at the same time are calling for reunification of Germany. Is that not a dangerous division of policy or opinion on the part between us and our allies?
The Western proposals on Germany and Berlin over the years have been on the basis of agreement. And the record there is filled with proposals to give the Germans a chance to decide on such questions as unification. Now, when new approach or a new move is made, such as was made in the Russian aid memoir that was delivered to us at Vienna, you can expect all the governments directly involved to review the entire history of the situation, consult with each other, and decide how to move from here. I myself am confident that there will be unity and agreement among the governments directly concerned, and that disunity is not going to be the problem.
Well, someone said that the art of diplomacy is to avoid dead ends. Do you think that both sides have avoided a dead end at this stage of the game in Berlin?
Well, I think it's important not to come to the dead end, but to explore every possibility of working out a tolerable peace that is consistent with the vital interests of our own country.
Some people have interpreted Mr. Khrushchev's speech yesterday as an indication that he is in a diplomatic hole that he's got himself into, and he is almost appealing for help from the West in getting out of it, that this was a much more moderate speech than some of its predecessors. Do you agree, sir?
Well, parsing a particular speech is sometimes a little hazardous. Of course, we read a speech of that sort with considerable care and interest. But in view of the record of the last several weeks, I think one would not wish to leap to conclusions too quickly on the basis of a single speech. After all, those of us who have to make speeches from time to time know how easy it is to say things a little differently and without necessarily implying too much by it. But this will be given very careful study, of course.
Well, Mr. Secretary, Berlin is topic A in the world. Can we talk to you about topic B, nuclear testing and disarmament? Have you any theories as to why the Russians, who seem to be interested in reaching a treaty to ban the nuclear tests with us for several years, suddenly this year seem to have lost interest in it?
There may be several reasons which move them in that direction. I think Mr. Khrushchev, in his aid memoir on the subject and in some of the things that have been said in speeches and other places, made it quite clear as to what one of the reasons is. They have made, it seems to me, a far-reaching and fundamental decision about their attitude toward international organizations and international arrangements on such things as inspection and control. Their experiences in the Congo and their estimate of the effect of the actions taken by the United Nations in the Congo upon their policies in that country led them to say that we are not going to subject the interests of the Soviet Union to decisions made by somebody else. Now, this is essentially the origin of the so-called Troika formula, that in these matters there will be a communist, a capitalist, a neutral, and that each one of them would have a veto on action taken. Well, now, obviously, this would lead, if this is the principle on which the inspection machinery is organized and operated, obviously this would lead to self-inspection or to an ability to bar effective inspection and control. And that would be unacceptable for the rest. I think it's also important to bear in mind that for the Soviet Union, secrecy is a very great strategic advantage as they see it. Their communications on the subject of disarmament, nuclear test control, suggest that they look upon international inspection and control as a form of espionage. That effective control discloses secrets within the Soviet Union. Well, this is for them a serious step. But for the rest of us, it is a vital step, because we find it difficult to see how you can proceed down the path toward disarmament unless you have reasonable assurances that none of us will be, as Aristide Briand once put it, dupes or victims in this business. So we have been discouraged, although not surprised, we've been discouraged by the attitude of the Soviet government in the recent nuclear test discussions in Geneva. We had hoped that we could get that agreement, not because this represents a major step in disarmament, but because it was a most significant first step, and it would have established the principle of inspection and control and given us some experience in the actual operation of a system of inspection and control, which would then open the way for further steps in the disarmament that we all would like to accomplish if we can find a way to do it consistent with our security.
Well, Mr. Secretary, right now there are calls on Capitol Hill and elsewhere in the government to resume testing. From the diplomatic viewpoint, do you think after a three-year moratorium that the damage it would do to our prestige and power among the neutrals who we've been trying to woo the most is worth the military gains that we would get out of resuming testing?
Well, this is a very serious question which must, of course, preoccupy the mind of President Kennedy. He commented on it yesterday. I think that when we balance up these matters, we will find that, in the first place, the world does understand that there is on the table at Geneva a reasonable, workable treaty submitted with bona fides looking toward the suspension of tests and the establishment of a genuine test ban system. Now, I don't think we should assume that because people in other parts of the world, as well as our own people, would hope that progress can be made on these matters, that they would not fail to understand that the rest of the world has a vital interest in the steps that the United States may have to take in the protection of its own elementary security.
Mr. Secretary.
So this is a matter for the future. It has to be, this is something that the President will have to decide in the weeks and months ahead.
Mr. Walter Lippmann has raised the possibility that Mr. Khrushchev may want tests resumed because Russian scientists need them more than we do at this point. Is there any feeling in our government that that may be true?
That is the kind of question which will have to be examined, but I think that it would not be useful for me to comment upon where the advantages might lie in this circumstance. This is something that has to be judged on a highly technical basis involving many classified elements, and I think any observation on my part would be beside the point.
Can we turn to Latin America?